Welcome everyone to this FPGA live stream. UL-X3S with 84K logic cell, ECP5, and as usual with this live streams where we finally achieved and unlocked something, let's start with a previously already known from the icebreaker work 16-bit digital audio playback from the 50 megahertz on 50 megahertz RISC-V on this FPGA. And continues a little bit longer. It's probably enough. That were 4 megabyte of CD quality, also mono. Also with this FPGA, we have enough, more than enough logic cells left here for doing stereo. However, some notes so that you learn something at home. So why have I? Oh, this was the wrong screen. Center three. So why have I done this and why is it newsworthy? So on the original RISC-V, so there is this RISC-V example for the UL-X3S, and as I mentioned, for the icebreaker is, well, also sold publicly. There is more of a community already. This was from university, and the UL-X3S board still coming there to crowdfunding, so I'm among the few hundred people or so working on this. And while there are plenty examples, including NES and Amiga, some of this stuff is hard to find, and this is also what these videos are for, to share what we have learned and for you to have it easier to get started when you decide to go with something like this if it comes to crowdfunding and stuff. So why have I done this? So, or what have I done? What? So this example that we also integrated our video core and audio core in already, only used the FPGA, meaning it didn't use the memory, the SD memory, of which we have 32 megabytes that also we have to do next. And also it didn't use the flash, by the way, there on that side, this is the same flash as on the icebreaker, that is this serial WinBond 16 megabyte 128 Mbit flash, quite large. So this is exactly the same flash as on the icebreaker, and the reason I wanted to use this is this original example with the RISC-V was purely running this memory built out of either memory cells or logic elements on the FPGA, and I wanted to have those of building this microprocessor system here, reference platform of ours with audio and video for the icebreaker and for the UL-X3S. I wanted to have them as close or similar as possible, meaning to also run the code, for example, from the flash. And one drawback also, why do I want to do this? Because right now, each time by the way, I hope the audio is fine, I didn't double check it. So it was super annoying for me each time we reset this here, make a change in the source code, for example, just a space and save it again. So best not with one hand, did I even save it? Save, yes. And run this here, UL-X3 proc, then because of the nature, this example was set up of only using FPGA resources for this tutorial. It is now resynthesizing the whole FPGA, although we have not changed a single logic statement there in Verilog or so. This is because the firmware is compiled. You see it here, RISC-V 64 T2 Linux and GCC here. and then processed into firmware hex file. And this is used as initialization here for the FPGA. And also probably don't need to run this and maybe cause drop frames. And so this is super annoying, certainly for me to develop new stuff when each time you make a tiny little change to your C or C++ or soon microkernel in whatever, Rust or whatever, then you wait maybe a minute or two depending on your system and processor and such to resynthesize this and upload the full FPGA bitstream, which in this case is nearly 2 megabytes because 84,000 logic cells. So starting already from it is the edit compile test cycle is super long this way and certainly not for us in the long term. The way they have done this in the Icebreaker, which by the way I should also check here. I have this. So in the Icebreaker, this is why I wanted these examples ideally as similar as possible. And as you see here from the Icebreaker proc, that they program this here, the FPGA bitstream, which is like 1 megabyte or so for the, also this is not the Icebreaker, but doesn't really matter. And then with 1 megabyte, one megabyte offset, the firmware, meaning our machine code for the RISC-V core here. And to do the same, this took way longer than it should. Took me literally probably in total, no kidding, it probably nearly took me like 8 hours because early adapter. And so why is this? You would think this is the same I square C SPI, it's the same SPI flash. And by the way, that you also learn something. So SPI is a super simple protocol, serial protocol used for a lot of things. And so you're only using a master and slave protocol, you're using only 4 data lines, clock, master out, slave in, and master in, slave out, and select. And you could also use this in dual and quad configuration, like meaning, so this is a classic vintage original 1 data line thing. You can also, like, those can be bi-directional, and then you have like dual or with another data line or 2 data lines, quad, which is used on the Icebreaker and probably we could use here. But to speed this up for 2 or 4 times as high speed. And the protocol is as simple as you would expect. Here with the clock signal and select, and then the master in, slave out, and master out, slave in, addressing this, so sending commands and addresses, commands meaning read, write, erase, and so on, or switch mode to dual and quad mode. And so super simple protocol. You would wonder, why do I need 8 hours for this? Well, I need 8 hours because I couldn't even find the pins. So the lesson learned here is if the documentation is not amazing and Google also not, then stuff takes forever. So what took the longest among the longest is finding here this custom Verilog for the pin configuration. So this would be flash. So this flash clock thing here didn't work at all, and this took forever to find, and that is somewhere where was it? So this is this one. I naively tried, so my first my first attempt might have even worked, but as so often, it's not one thing, it's then 3 things coming together, and in total, instead of just working, you waste 1 hour there, or you spend 1 hour learning details. And so what is the other hold up is that this didn't synthesize for me, maybe intentionally, because the pin configuration, LPF, if you try to use ECP5 clock here, which is flash This is a pin constraint assignment file here for the Verilog, defining on this board which pin goes to what, because obviously each and everyone could connect all those pins on the FPGA to whatever they want, like LEDs and like RGB gaming lighting LEDs and other fun stuff like SPI flash and general purpose differential interface stuff, like not to call it HDMI. So this clock pin, so this maybe even the authors didn't know themselves, or this changed in the open source Trellis, Yosys and XPNR stuff, because if you try to use this pin, it doesn't synthesize. The error message is something like the package, like pin U3 is not known in this package. And I Googled this and I Googled examples. There are extremely little examples out there. Actually, I found zero examples for SPI flash here on this board. And only when I then turned to this Gitter where the developers discusses, I ask here, by the way, hello, amazing board and stuff. Is there an example for SPI flash? And then they pointed me to this NES emulation, which is here, where I have shamelessly stolen that. But even that did not instantly work. This is where I got this pin configuration from. I already guessed that I need something like this, but I didn't find it with Google. So what this is doing is you have here a wire, we define a wire, like a freestanding wire, and a tree state that is off. And then we define here user mode clock, because I guess that is because this pin, this U3 pin, is where the clock should be for loading the bitstream from when this FPGA boots, like power on cycle. I guess that is this are the pins where the SPI flash should be, and this is why maybe these pins have some special configuration glue there, and this is why you cannot like use it through regular means, because it's reserved and special meaning for that. This is my guess. If you know more details, it's only as much as I could learn from it. Google 8 hours spending with this, reading documentation, source code and trialing around. So this basically defines a user mode clock for this flash thing here to, without the regular pin constraint mapping, define this flash. So this took already like 2 hours. And then I took the code here from the NES example, which was basically actually PicoSoC derived. So again, this project we built up on this PicoSoC examples. And I want to keep this as close as possible, so that we have this our RX32, our reference RISC-V audio and video homebrew microprocessor system, to have both share as much code as possible, to have the share the same bugs and the same bug fixes. And so, also people going crazy in their car. Really wonder why people need to constantly honk so much, but and irritate here YouTubers. And so when we take a look into this flash code here from the NES emulator, which was this is NES, and this flash here, so we have here flash mem and flash loader. And first I copied both of them in and studied them and came to the conclusion. So this is the main SPI interface. Also, by the way, I think it's a typo. I think they meant PicoSoC. I think there is a P missing. I also slightly wonder why they, or EcoSoc, I don't know. This is a little bit strange, because this code is quite identical to what we inherited from Claire's PicoSoc and Pico RV32. And so first I copied this in, tried to get it to work, then I realized this is like 80% the same of our PicoSoc stuff. Also, they have here a loader, so they have here a flash loader, which takes care of this addressing, like mapping the NES cartridge addressing to this flash memory, because the FPGA bitstream comes first in this flash, certainly from address zero. So in this SPI flash, as the FPGA boots from this power on, loads the bitstream. Bitstream meaning our synthesized design, defining what all those logic cells should be doing and the pins and also routing. This is a FPGA bitstream similar to compiler object of your source code. And of course, the bitstream comes first from address 0. So we need our custom data, like RISC-V code or other emulator game data needs to come after this. So this is what this offset here is doing. And so first I copied all of this in, and then I deleted all of this, and then most of it, and then I arrived here at a state that is relatively close. And again, long term, like in a day or two, I want to share this 100% with. If you were wondering, this is just the regular Intel Xeog driver, amazing stuff, and like graphic corruption artifacts, because it is what the Intel programmers are known for. So SPIMEM, I think this was this one. No, this is not. This is a PicoSoC SPI Flash 2 is our temporary. So this is our temporary derived from the NES, but in a day or two, I want to fully have the PicoSoC one working. The PicoSoc is more complicated because it supports dual and quad mode, and so it has like twice the code, and first I had to get this working. So you see here, these are the input and outputs, the SPI chip select, clock, master out, source in, and master in, source out, the serial communication lines here as seen here in the protocol. And I extended this, so this read data was only 8-bit. And so I cleaned this up, I deleted everything from NES stuff we don't need. So this is like 90% PicoSoC now as it was, without the dual and quad mode, which I need to get working next. And I changed the read data because our RISC-V CPU is 32-bit. And we usually want to get 32-bit out of it with each read, like each instruction and each read, usually most of the time being 32-bit. From the NES, it was 8-bit, and again, we need 32. So the beauty is, I read the specification, like reading the freaking manual, and it turns out that, so this is what I added, it turns out if you address this, so this works by starting here, writing the command, like 3 is read, read from this, and then we output the address with a clock there on the flash. So as so many protocols, usually it is the same, like some commands and some data, and like data out and data in. So command 3, then address out, and the address that we want to read from the serial EEPROM. And then we get the data back. And the beauty is, I suspected this, I read the freaking manual, and it's documented in the manual that you only need one read command, and then it outputs data as long as the chip select and clock is going. Theoretically, we could also Google this here to fact check that, always the best here, that probably was either this or this. Data sheet also, in my opinion, shout out to companies, this should be the norm, that data sheets are always available. I think it was even mentioned there, like whole or entire, there was a sentence of groups of arrays, entire memory array can be hardware protected, allows a portion of the entire memory array to be configured read only. So much too, I've read the freaking manual, even still know the wording. So read data command 03 hex, and here it's also documented that after the address is received, the data byte of the addressed memory location will be shifted out on the data out pin, the open at the falling edge of the clock with the most significant MSB bit first. The address is automatically incremented to the next higher address after each byte of data is shifted out, allowing for a continuous stream of data. This means that the entire memory can be accessed with a single instruction as long as the clock continues, and the instruction is completed by driving chip select high. And we use this here so that I changed this. The NES was only using 8-bit at a time, but we need 32-bit. So this works. So this is a state machine. This is a state of command address. And then I added here 3 more states of the next 3 consecutive auto-incremented bytes. This still didn't work, so of course I had to additionally wire this into this module here. Here are all the flash pins, as you do with Verilog. This is our top module, our ULX3S. And now new are these flash things here. Also, we need this passing this down to this AtoSoC, which again in a day or two will be our PicoSoC as shared with Icebreaker. So passing all these pins and wires here, input and outputs through all the modules here and here for the instantiating this flash mem, which again in a day or two will be simple SPI flash from Claire as soon as I get it to work. So the other reason why this didn't work, of course, you need to have here all the addressing correctly. So we also need to wire it up for the RISC-V core to addresses, because nothing works magically by itself. So we need to define this valid is the chip select here for the flash mem. And so this is, if the address is higher than the built-in memory, so this are the 4x4 2-bit words. If the address is higher than the built-in as in built-in to the design of the FPGA, 64K at the moment, I think, then, and the address is lower than this 200,000 hex, 60 megabytes or so, then this should be addressed, this address line. And this also didn't work because took me also another hour or two to debug. So you synthesize something, you design something, it doesn't work, and then hunting these bugs sometimes takes forever, especially if you don't have a logic analyzer with you and do this on your laptop here on a kitchen table. So after another hour or two of guru meditation, I found that they modified, they of ULX3 tutorial fame, they modified this, because again, this is derived from Claire's PicoSoC, and in the PicoSoC it worked on the Icebreaker. And then after a long debugging session and guru meditation, I found out that they modified the memory addressing here somewhere, like RAM ready. And they had here, so this was their memory, they built in 64K memory, and they had here, I think I added like this, so they, and then I was, the issue is with this code is that if the later part here, the end memory address, so originally in this example, in this tutorial, it was like this. This means always when the memory was selected, like there was a valid memory address to be read, and they always read this because they did not check for, or they actually intentionally deleted. I have no idea why, because in the PicoSoC example, this line reads like this, and this means to only actually use the memory when the memory address is actually in the memory region and not like always. Due to that, our flash was never read because the memory always instantly said, hey, yeah, we have memory. And yeah, our flash stuff didn't get to actually read it. So yeah, this kind of stuff, but this is hardware design. One little wire somewhere, some addressing logic deleted or incorrect or something, and yeah, 1 or 2 hours easily gone with trying to get this work. The next hour I spent actually verifying that this works, because even so, with this I saw some data coming. So before this I saw data that didn't make sense for the flash area. This is what I have here, this ULXware for, and I was outputting here some data, like hex formatted data, and this didn't make the most sense. And because I was trying to flash, so I saw this is flash, but not the flash I wanted to read. And the another, I kid you not, I spent like literally another 2 hours just figuring out how this freaking tools work. So tools written in C, the most basic, they just work if you run them the way this UJ proc. So yeah, this is what happens when you write the most minimal stuff in C that just does what it's supposed to do. So turns out I tried to flash data, and so first of all, if I try to flash here data let's try this. So yeah, this fails, and so I debugged, like, and first I debugged or read the source. I always like read the freaking source. It so it turns out it has some special meaning to programming. So it turns out it does not write all raw data. It so the file name needs to match. Took me some 50 minutes to figure out and test around there. And then even then, the data I flashed, the problem is I sometimes hit Control C because the data is so large. The audio file is some 8 megabyte or 12 megabyte, and I hit Control C. So this output here is also not amazing, because probably maybe I patch it to flashing, because what it's doing here is it's not programming. It's erasing first. So I wasted another 30, 40 minutes, always, because I canceled this, and sometimes I mostly erased this, and then I wondered why the heck is my flash now reading FFFF when this program was not yet programming, it was only erasing for like forever. So yeah, if now your tools and it would actually be cool if there would be some unified flashing tool for all of this that would be like totally user friendly. The problem with this most minimal flashing tools is, like, even with me 20 years experience, it doesn't do what you want. You read the source, it doesn't something, and you hit Control C and easily 30, 40, 50 minutes spent just learning how these tools work. So yeah, but now if you name the file image for flash some raw image, then yeah, just rename it. This here is the offset, 2 megabyte, so 2 megabyte meaning after the bitstream. And next. So this is the long story of how you can easily spend like 8 hours on getting your SPI flash to work after like basically falling for each issue that is lingering along the way. Now it's working finally, but even after 8 hours in, also for the open hardware and software world, often I mentioned this before, like fixing some small AMD GPU thing or Intel CPU thing, often it takes, what also my customers usually don't understand, often it takes like 8 hours to figuring out some small detail of some AMD GPU stuff or Linux kernel file system corruption stuff, easily takes a week. And at the end, the patch is only a one-liner, right? But the one-liner of better FS, journaling condition of AMD GPU memory, IOMMU or whatever bits and stuff, it usually takes many hours just to debug a stray random glitch. And then the customer say, I should pay 8 or 20 hours for this one liner. It's like, yeah, it's not the issue. It's a one liner. It's all the setup, debugging, reading the source, going through the source and so on. This story is not yet over. So so much to how much does it cost to create tutorials and document all the stuff for you to not spend 8 hours on this and have a working example. So next, this is, as I said, not the full story yet. I still need to change the example. So next, meaning changing the example so that we run the code from the flash just for the feature parity with Icebreaker. And again, it's of course nicer to develop if you edit compile flash in 10 seconds instead of 2 minutes of resynthesizing the whole design with a firmware being inside the FPGA bitstream. So that is what we will do next. But even this is not easy. This means changing this linker script here. Well, mostly it will be testing. We have this already from Icebreaker. It's, maybe this. On the previous live stream, I commented everything out. This is a linker script of where all the stuff should go. So the text, as you probably see here, we need to change or reuse the Icebreaker, and then most likely even change maybe the reset address, because then our reset address will not be zero, but starting at maybe 2 megabytes into the flash or something. So quite some details, likely another 2, 3, 4 hours to get the RISC-V code running directly from the SPI flash. Then of course other stuff like reusing the simple UART from PicoSoC entirely, including its performance optimized quad SPI mode. For that, however, I know already that we need the next thing. So for the quad SPI mode, we need more special pin configuration here, meaning we need to define, we need output enable controls. So we need some other custom trellis defines here for pin configuration for having a tree state, meaning that we can input, output and high set those all the pins for quad SPI mode, because then we have input and output on multiple on like 2 or 4 of those pins. So this means another googling and copy and pasting of other examples of trellis tree state defines here. So I will do this last. First I will get this code working, then we can share the same firmware for our RX32 little on the Icebreaker and RX32 big on the ULX3S. But with this, of course, it's increasingly fun to have all the stuff working, including next, of course, how will we make this even more amazing is using the SD card here, implementing this so that next also in a week or two having regular files being loaded, so then we could play in WAV file or maybe even MP3 or so if we're lucky, depending on our RISC-V performance. And SD card, and also next the SDRAM. With the SDRAM controller, maybe we also actually use it from the NES project here, because reusing others open hardware definition always, of course, nice. The beauty of this SD thing here is, but even the SDRAM will not be the most easy. But yes, hardware, software, you see all the Intel bugs and other security vulnerabilities here on this and the other More Life channel in the news. For the SD memory, maybe we use this example here on the SDRAM controller from the NES here. However, the SDRAM is 16-bit. So what we need to do is we need 2 cycles. So we need a little bit of glue code for loading 2 addresses automatically, also for each RISC-V access potentially. So there is a little bit of, so often we cannot just take it and it will work. We can take it as a base, modify it a little bit for that. Also, this has already code here for primary and secondary. So this is like 2 dual port. So like integrated graphics here for data output and request from the CPU and the PPU with a pixel processing unit or so from the NES. So very theoretically, we could even use it for our own video to have some integrated graphic mode, maybe in the future, reusing this code. So, but yeah, maybe, maybe not. Probably for the beginning, I will delete this. We can at a later point always like copy and paste it back from the NES project there. But the reason I will probably not do this in the beginning, first of all, complexity and compatibility with the Icebreaker to have not too much code differences for the RX32 little and RX32 big system. But last but not least, of course, this will reduce performance for the RISC-V. So probably for the beginning anyway, we take all the double data rate cycles and load like 32-bit to advanced addresses, 32-bit from the 16-bit bus here, and maximize RISC-V performance or something of that sort. But anyway, that's probably all the update and next steps here for this project. I hope you enjoy it as much as we do and learn something and have fun with it. Quite some progress again. also for stereo, some things are low-hanging fruits. For the icebreaker, already said we can easily have stereo, just that we didn't have any logic cells left. So we could, with this board, and yes, graphic corruptions also piss me off a little bit. Intel's maintenance of the XORG driver or the lack thereof. For, where's our audio somewhere? Oh, all not loaded. To make the stereo, this is super easy. I said this already, just instantiated here twice, and we had here already the right deck defined here, so we can easily make it stereo, and probably I will make it next week or so when we first step by step finish the SPI integration to run from SPI to not have the machine code in the FPGA bitstream, then maybe even do the SD card first, the fun of loading a file system here, like FAT file system, and playing files from that, and then memory and stereo and other fun stuff. As always, thanks for tuning in. I hope you learned something. Leave me in the comments below what you find interesting or not, what we could do better, or what you would like to see. Again, long term, having a nice programmable system with video and audio, like a modern system with RISC-V core. Of course, if you are into retro and vintage stuff, you can just use the code, it's out there, Game Boy, NES, Amiga, of all things here, you can emulate and implement a full Amiga in here if you wanted to. But my goal is here to have some modern examples of being able to define our own hardware, not like working what they've done in the 80s, but writing, not being limited of whatever they had done there, and spending our time with each bit and emulating this, but doing new stuff, showing you how it works under the hood, and that we all learn something and have modern systems for open hardware and open GPUs and certainly RISC-V to come. That is probably for this video. Oh, now we have some more comments. So Electron Ash is there. And Electron Ash has been staring at Ethereum code a lot recently. Still practical, the same, most of the Mr. cores. Burst writes for the... Electron Ash has hopes to add burst writes for the Jaguar core. Welcome, Christian. So this is, it's not annoying. So this is a WinBond. I had this earlier on the data sheet here. Probably we maybe still have it here. So this is, should be this one. It's the same as in the icebreaker. Very, very convenient that they both use the same, a very high performance. I think it can run at 100, 150 megahertz or something. So this is regular SPI. So super easy to use, like this super serial 4-wire SPI protocol, although you can optionally use dual and quad mode for dual and quad performance. And 128 megabit, super large, 16 divided by 8, 16 megabytes, the same as on the icebreaker. And last but not least, I forgot to mention, I checked the write cycles, and the write cycles are 100,000, so more than 100,000 erase program cycles. I was a little bit worried of if this only is 1,000, it could quickly get destroyed, like in the ThinkPad Thunderbolt controller stuff. But 100,000 erase program cycles should probably not get to that, I guess, even with our 8-hour marathon of reflashing it. Just another data point for you at home to know what kind of numbers, what kind of ballpark we're talking here. So more than 100,000 erase program cycles advertise more than 20 years data retention, meaning you put it in the shelf and the data is still there in the flash, and 104 megahertz single dual quad SPI clocks, and then 208 460 megahertz equivalent. So this is not megahertz of clock, this is, they just multiply this with dual and quad for dual and quad Dual and Quad Performance, 40 megabit or is it megabyte or megabit? Not sure. 50 should probably should this be 50 megabyte? Continuous data anyway, whatever. So yeah, what else do we have? Anonymous writes FPGA addiction is a real thing. Yeah, it is. The Winbond chip on MISTERS only reach around 140 megahertz on the MEM test, but then the DE10 nano headers were never really meant to run quite that fast. PCB layout isn't ideal. DRAM electronics means not flash. But the Alliance SDRAM chips were getting the full 166 megahertz on the all-in-one board. Yeah, so this is it Alliance? Yeah, this is Alliance. So yeah, let's see what we are getting when we implement this. Some live stream soon. If you want to see all those details, then probably don't forget to share, like, and subscribe. Quad SPI flash looks interesting, but some of them require quite a few clock cycles just to set up a new address. And they're also quite slow to erase, rewrite the chip usually. Yeah, this program, so the icebreaker is relatively fast. This programming, this UJ proc is not the fastest. Maybe only in single, not dual or quad mode. This is also why this is super annoying. And why I wanted this to work as soon as possible, like now. And then my edit compile cycle for the RISC-V stuff is much faster again. So, and also more memory, right? Right now, this way we have 16 mega or 14 megabyte of data for games and audio and stuff, and plus SD card, obviously, instead of having this in the FPGA bit stream where we rather use the memory for VGA and sound DMA and stuff. And let's see, Christian writes, could be Panic Room by Fairlight. Ash, I'm obsessed with that one, absolutely. Mental 64K demo. Deadlock by Elwood. Okay, people discuss their collection of mods looking for years. PC Magazine, Serum, something around 1993. Cool stuff. Yeah, always just leave the comments below, also demos, and we also had captures of the Unreal demos and stuff on 3GAs. And yeah, this is also what is coming then to this board. Let's see what, theoretically, it's a pity that this Unreal demos and stuff were written in assembler, so not easy to port to the RISC-V here, but maybe one day in some months or later, we come up with some nice demos that also better looking than ASCII graphic here, now that we have plenty of memory to play with this. And if you discuss your demos, leave it in the comments below. Always fun to look good demos and good PC music, computer generated soundtrack stuff. That's it for this video. Now I probably go back to the drawing board and wire up all the linking section and startup code to be fully the same, except the startup address, probably icebreaker 1 megabyte, and this ULX3X 2 megabyte. We can quickly verify this. Let's see, either in icebreaker V, this reset address, or where do we have the Pico sock off? Here's, by the way, there you see all the output enable for all the quad, so this is, yeah, many more wires there for quad SPI mode. Where is even, maybe it's in Pico sock then. So here, this is 1 megabyte. So there you see, this is what I'm talking about. This is what we need to modify also, among other things, to have the program execute from the, this is here, synthesizing your own CPU, then the reset vector. This will be the only difference, the reset vector as expected on the icebreaker with 1 megabyte bitstream for the FPGA. So the RISC-V code, 1 megabyte into the flash. And this will be the only difference for our bigger system with 2 megabyte into the flash after the bitstream. So yeah, theoretically, knowing this, we could, because we have no use for, but again, we have 32-bit. I was only saying we could PC-like make the video memory inside the first 1 megabyte low memory, because there is no useful right now. There is a FPGA bitstream. You could read the FPGA bitstream, just doesn't have much use for it. So yeah, theoretically we could have the PC compatible video memory, but yeah, then again, we have 32-bit linear address space, don't really need to optimize for that. We probably just leave it where it is at the end of the memory, because why not more PC VGA compatible anyway. But yeah, that's it for this live stream. Okay, some more comments. What do we have here? People discussing their 16-bit stuff, 1989. Amazing stuff. Could probably use a 68 core, some old demos, but have to write most of the Amiga core or something. Yeah, people have written the Amiga core, right? You can just flash Amiga on this. Maybe I do this for testing another day. So you don't need to write this. People have done this. So UL-X3S Amiga. And so yeah, this is a thing. There is a Verilog, so this apparently, according to those folks, there works Verilog somewhere of Myst or something. ULX. So somewhere it is there, Mini versus somewhere, yeah. Some of those links is that. So people have done this for you. You just need to compile it or take the binary and flash it, and you have an Amiga, which certainly is amazing. Which brings me to my this. I said this before. I probably can say it again. The one thing that I thought is probably pretty cool is this X. I was considering, like, maybe get this nice system there from Japan, just that they are forbiddably expensive. Of what probably many of you don't know, also 68,000, and the later ones with MMU and can run NetBSD. Maybe it's time to implement a 68 in FPGA. Then I don't need to spend $1,000 or $2,000 for the risk of importing this really fun system. Maybe this is something. If this video gets enough likes and stuff, and maybe for the 100,000 subscriber celebration we do this, if not some nobody else has done it until then. But yeah, your tweet for the stream just appeared on the ULX3S homepage. Ah, that is cool. Thanks for that, bots and AI, amazing stuff. So Mini Micros ULX already took roughly 20,000 logic elements for that, and equivalent lots on EC, don't know the equivalent lots on the ECP5. So all of those people who build a card cabinets using Raspberry Pis will soon want an FPGA instead, since hardware emulators is far. Yeah, so this is the thing, the software emulation is not only quite CPU cycle intensive, this is why you need a quad core, like 2 or 3 gigahertz quad core with fancy graphic card GPU to emulate PS3, to emulate all the cells and stuff. And the same, to emulate on a Raspberry Pi, you need quite some CPU cycle overhead for all the sprite blitting, for all the timers, all the cycle accuracy. Just look how slow DOS emulator, DOS emu, DOS box runs, or QEMU without KVM for all the low-level bit precise flags and conditional flags and all the other hardware-specific register and memory management unit stuff. So this is why I said, when people said with the Icebreaker, why do I use an Icebreaker, not a Raspberry Pi? Well, first of all, this is writing your own hardware, much more amazing than a slow ARM core. I had enough of this. Much more thrilling and learning experience in your own hardware. And then you can implement vintage and retro hardware. Hardware perfect, and not like on Raspberry Pi where stuff is glitchy and a little bit off and stuff. So yeah. It's just a matter of how much time you want to spend implementing like logic element perfect copy implementing old hardware without glitches, without slowdowns, without imperfections. It's lost. Yeah, well, imperfections as long as you find the bugs, and then it's perfect if you want to. And as I mentioned, the Raspberry Pi only has one CPU, so one CPU, well, and a crappy GPU. So one clock cycle, one instruction, and on this, all the stuff is running in parallel, all your logic elements. If you have your video and audio, it's not like you need multi-CPU for that. All the logic elements, depending on how you wire them up together, they all switch there at your clock rate. And this is what makes this FPGA hardware stuff so powerful in means of whatever you wanna, whatever you dream up and you write Verilog and you synthesize, you have there with on this board 84,000 logic cells at your fingertip. There is an x86 core on Mista already, but nobody knows enough Japanese to get it running more games. Doesn't need more work though. Oh, that is cool. Thanks for looking that up. Maybe that is something to try. Electron has got a Minimic core running on a 28-pound SIG 2 board from AliExpress years ago. Just took up the PS2 keyboard, mouse, SD card, joystick ports. Yeah. I think the ULX, some more comments. ULX3 Minimic ECS fits on. Yeah, they wrote this there. So yeah, maybe even 12,000 logic elements are enough for that. Not that it makes such a difference if the PCB, like many, if you manufacture this low quantity, the PCB costs some, and then it doesn't even matter much if the FPGA costs 10, 20, 30 euro more or less. But yeah, you could use a smaller one if you wanted to. That is correct. Jammer adapter for misters. Not quite rooted yet, will be the next project for after the board year. So what it's called, board LLC occurred at the moment, low latency control, 68k is quite hard to get the timing right. Some instructions take more or less cycles depending on the instructions before and after and how the heck emulates it. Well, if that is the case, it probably is. If you implement the logic similarly of using shared resources, then, well, not sure if people have done a full decap and tracing all those logic elements on this, but well, you could certainly implement the logic in just such a way that it's using the same logic, just like, yeah, finding this out without decapping and microscope and tracing all those logic cells might be a little bit challenging indeed. FX68K on the Mister is apparently cycle accurate now, but it hasn't been independently verified. Seems pretty darn accurate during testing though. Yeah, exactly. So amazing stuff. Also amazing stuff that so many people tuned in here. Always more fun with more people tuning in. Also nice to see that although we do so many random FPGA live streams, people still keep subscribing. I probably need to really edit some pre-edited videos soon to also engage more people who are in more pre-edited, more other real life stuff. So coming soon to this channel. Thanks for watching. Hope you learned something, and to see you soon for other videos and live streams to come.